men and women, parents and children, family and marriage. The Third Testament, Revelations of Jesus Christ, Chapter 33. The relationship between man and woman. Thus saith the Lord. Before you arrived on earth, I already knew your way and your inclinations, and to help you in your journey, I put in your path a heart that by its love for you would illuminate your road. The heart may be that of a man or a woman. Thus I have wished to help you so that you may serve as a staff of faith, moral force and clarity for the needy. I wanted you to participate in the joy of being parents, to create beings similar to yourselves, beings to whom I would send spirits to incarnate. Since maternal love exists in the divine and eternal, I wanted there to exist in the human life a being who would represent it, and that being is the woman. In the beginning, the human being was divided into two parts, thus creating two sexes, one the man and the other the woman. He would have strength, intelligence, and majesty. The woman would have tenderness, grace, and beauty. The man as a seed, and the woman as the fertile land. There you have two beings who can feel complete, perfect, and happy only when they are united. For with their harmony, they will form one single body, one single will, and one single ideal. This union, when inspired by the conscience and by love, is called matrimony. Truly, I say to you, I see that in this time, man and woman have deviated from their path. I discover men who forsake their responsibilities, women who flee from their maternity, and others who invade the fields of predestined for man, when since ancient times you were told that the man is the head of the woman. Not because of that should the woman feel scorned. For today I say to you that the woman is the heart of the man. That is why I have instituted and sanctified matrimony, because in the union of those two beings, spiritually equal but corporeally different, a perfect condition prevails. How few are those who aspire to live in the paradise of peace, light, and harmony, lovingly obeying the divine laws. Humanity has traveled over a very long path, and it still prefers to eat the forbidden fruits, which only accumulate sorrow and disappointment in its life. The forbidden fruits are those which, while being good because they have been created by God, can become harmful to man if he has not properly prepared himself, or if he consumes them excessively. Man and woman take the fruit of life without preparation, unaware of their responsibility before the Creator when they bring new beings to incarnate on earth. Some ask me, Lord, by chance is human love wrong and abominable in your sight? Do you only approve of spiritual love? No, people. It is true that to the spirit correspond the highest and purest loves, but in the flesh I also deposited a heart to love with, and I gave it senses, so that through them you may love what surrounds you. That love that rests only in the material is characteristic of the irrational beings, because they lack a conscience that illuminates their paths. On the other hand, I tell you that good unions must bring forth good fruits, and incarnate in them spirits of light. I have not come to ask superhuman sacrifices of you, neither have I asked that men cease being men to follow me, nor that women cease being women to fulfill a spiritual mission. I have not separated the husband from his wife, nor the wife from her husband to serve me, nor to parents have I said to abandon their children and cease working to follow me. To one and all, upon converting them to laborers in my fields, I have made them understand that by being my servants, they do not cease to be human, and therefore must know to give to God what is God's, and to the world what is of the world. The nature and duty of the man. To you men, I have granted a heritage, a a treasure, a woman of whom you are the overseers, in order to love and preserve her. And nevertheless, your companion has come to present her complaints and tears to me because of your lack of understanding. I have said that you are strong, that you have been created in my image and likeness, but I have not sent you to humiliate the woman and make her your slave. I have given you strength, so that you may represent me in your home, strong in virtue, in talent, and I have given you a woman as a companion and as a complement in your earthly life, so that you may find fortitude to withstand the ordeals and vicissitudes through the love of both. Think, men, how many times have you made virtuous women fall into your net, finding in them the sensitive and weak spots? And those mirrors formerly clean, and now without their luster, you must make them reflect once again the clarity and beauty of their spirits. Why do you today deprecate the same that yesterday you induced to perdition? Why do you complain of the degeneration of women? Understand that if you had led them on the path of my law, which is the law of the heart and the conscience, of respect and charity, loving them with a love that elevates instead of the passion that degrades, you would not now have a reason to cry and complain, and they would not have fallen. Men seek and demand that women have virtues and beauty. Why do you demand what you do not deserve? I see that you still believe yourselves to have great merits, in spite of falling short in them. Reconstruct with your works, words and thoughts that you have destroyed, giving honesty, morals, and virtue the value that is theirs. If you strive in this way, men, you will have helped Jesus in his work of salvation, and your hearts will feel joy when you contemplate the homes honored by good wives and worthy mothers. Your happiness will be great when you see virtue return to those who had lost it. Redemption is for everyone. Why should not even the most sinful be saved? For that reason, I tell you, men work with me to save those who have led to perdition, encouraging them with the light of my doctrine, and make my loving thoughts come to their minds and hearts. Bring them my messages in hospitals and prisons, even in the places of mire, for it is there that they cry in repentance and pain for not having been strong when the world with its temptations drag them toward perversion. Every woman was once a little girl. Every woman was once a virgin. And so you can reach their hearts on the path of sensitivity. To the men who have not tarnished these virtues, I will entrust this task. Remember that I have told you, by your works you shall be known. Let the spirit speak through the material form. However, to those who have not known how to respect the graces deposited by me in that being, I tell you, why say that you love, when it is not love that you feel? Why try to make others fall, letting nothing stop you? Think what would your heart feel if what you do with those plucked flowers were done with your mother, your sister, or with a woman you love, and therefore respect? Have you ever thought of the wounds you caused to the parents who raised their daughters with great love? Ask your heart in a true examination, in the light of your conscience, if you can reap what you have not sown. How can you prepare your future life if you are wounding your fellow men and women? How many victims will you have? What ending will you have? Truly, I tell you, that you have sacrificed many victims to the whirlwind of your passions, some of whom belong to your present, and others to your past. I desire that the heart and lips that have been a nest of perfidy and lies become a nest of truth and chaste love. Illuminate the paths of others by word and example, so that you may be the saviors of fallen women. Oh, if only each of you would redeem just one. Do not speak badly of that woman. The offensive word that wounds one wounds all who hear it, because from that instant all become unfit judges. Respect the actions and secrets of others, for it is not for you to judge them. I prefer to raise men fallen in sin over hypocrites who appear pure but sin. I prefer a sincere great sinner to the false pretense of virtue. If you wish to adorn yourselves, let it be with adornments of sincerity. If you find a virtuous woman of high sentiment, and you feel unworthy of her although you love her, and then speak badly of her and deprecate her, and if after suffering and understanding your error, you seek her for consolation, in vain will you call at her door. If every woman who has passed through the life of a single man had received from him the word and the feelings of love, respect, and understanding, your world will not now be at the height of sin in which it finds itself. Woman, wife, and mother. Women, it is you who, with your prayer, protect what little peace there is in the world, and who, as faithful guardians of the home, take care that it does not lack the warmth of love. In this way, you unite with Mary to break human arrogance. You women, who water the roads of this world with your tears, and who, with your blood, mark your passage through this life, rest in me to recover new strength, and to continue being the bearers of love, the fire of the heart, and the solid foundation of the home that I have entrusted to you on earth, so that you may continue being like a mother bird, spreading her wings to protect her husband and children. I bless you. I exalt the man and the place of the woman at his right. I sanctify marriage and bless the family. In this era, I come with a sword of love to put all things in their places, for men had put them elsewhere. Truly, I tell you that the regeneration of humanity must begin with the women, so that their fruit, which are the men of tomorrow, are found free of the stains that have led them to degeneration. Then it will correspond to men to their part in this work of reconstruction, for all who have corrupted a woman must regenerate her. Today I have inspired you to save the woman who has stumbled on her path, and when you present her to me, whom you have saved, I will give her a flower, a blessing, and very great peace, so that she will not fall again. If you fulfill this mission in this way, those beings wounded by the world will feel the love of Jesus enter their hearts. I shall listen when, in their prayers, they tell me, "My Father, do not see my sin, see only my pain. Do not judge my ingratitude, but see my suffering." In that instant, my comfort will descend to that troubled heart, and it will be purified by its tears. Oh, if you only knew how much more the prayer of the sinner is felt than that of the vain who believe themselves just and clean. Of the love with which I have given you life, men give little sign or evidence. Of all human emotions, that which comes closest to the divine love is maternal love, for in it is disinterest, abnegation, and the ideal of seeking the happiness of the child even at the cost of sacrifice. And to you, sterile women, the Master says, long have you desired and asked that your wombs be converted into fountains of life. You have hoped that when the evening or the morning approaches, a tender heart would be heard beating within you. But the days and nights have passed, and you have only shed tears, because the child has not arrived to call at your door. How many of you who are listening to me, and who have been deprived of hope by science, will have to bear fruit to believe in my power? Thus, through that miracle, many may recognize me. Watch and wait. Do not forget my words. The education of children and adolescents. Parents, avoid mistakes and bad examples. I do not demand perfection of you, only love and charity toward your children. Prepare yourself spiritually and physically, for the great legions of spirits from the beyond await the instant to incarnate among you. I want a new humanity which will grow and multiply, not only in number, but in virtue, so that it may become aware of the promised land nearby, and its children might be able to live in the new Jerusalem. I want the earth to be filled with men of goodwill, who are the fruits of love. Destroy the Sodom and Gomorrah of this time. Do not allow your hearts to become familiar with their sins, nor to imitate their inhabitants. Devotedly guide your children. Teach them to obey the spiritual and material laws. And if they break them, correct them, for you as parents represent me on earth. Therefore, remember Jesus, who filled with holy anger, gave the merchants of Jerusalem a lesson for all times, defending the divine cause, the unchangeable laws. Today you have ceased to be children, and you can now understand the essence of my teachings. You also know that your spirit was not born with the physical body you possess, and that the beginning of one is not of the other. Those children whom you rock in your arms carry innocence in their heart, but in their spirit they hold a past at times much larger and difficult than that of their parents themselves. How great a responsibility there is for those who must cultivate those hearts, so that their spirit attains progress along the road. Not because of this should you feel lesser love for your children. Think that you do not know who they are, nor what they have done. Rather, increase for them your charity and love, and be grateful to your Father for having placed in you His mercy to convert you into guides and counselors of your spiritual brothers, whose bodies you become parents of by blood. I say to parents of families that in the same manner that they worry about the material future of their children, they should also do so for their spiritual future, because of the mission which in that sense they have brought into the world. Understand that when the Spirit is made flesh, it brings with it all its gifts, that its destiny is already written, and therefore it need receive nothing in the world. It brings a message or restitution. At times it comes to gather a harvest, and other times to pay a debt. But always it comes to receive in this life a lesson of the love its Father gives it. You who are guiding your children through this life, once they are past the age of innocence, put them on the road of my law. Awaken their sentiments, reveal to them their gifts, and induce them always to the good. And truly I tell you, who in this way comes to me shall be bathed in the light that springs from the divine fire, which is my love. Spiritually, you have traveled a long road, and now you are surprised by the intuition and the development that the new generations show from their most tender infancy, because they are spirits that have lived much and now return to walk at the front of humanity, some on the paths of the Spirit, and others on the roads of the world, according to their gifts and their mission. Yet, in all of them, humanity will find peace. The beings of which I speak will be your children. Do you think that confronted with a bad example, by a vice, written, or evil parent on earth, the child commits an error in not continuing in that way of living? Or do you believe that the child is obliged to follow in the steps of his parents? Truly, I tell you, it must be the conscience and reason that guide you on the straight path. Blessed innocence is contaminated with the evil of the world. Youth runs a dizzying race, and the young women have quitted themselves of their modesty, their chastity, and their honesty. All these virtues have parted from their hearts. They have fed the worldly passions, and yearn only for those pleasures that lead them to the abyss. I come to speak to you with all clarity, so that you raise up and make a firm step in the evolution of your spirit. Ignite in youth the love of their fellow men, inspire in them great and noble ideals, for it will be they who tomorrow fight for an existence in which justice, love, and the sacred liberty of the spirit shine. prepare yourselves all, for the great battle of which the prophecies have spoken has not yet arrived. A word to the girls and young women. All spirits have in me a divine father, and if I have endowed you with human parents during your physical life, it is to give life to your body and to represent your heavenly father near you. I have said to you, love God above everything created, and I have added, honor your father and your mother. Therefore, do not neglect your responsibilities. If you have not recognized the love of your parents, and you still have them in this world, bless them and acknowledge their merits. On this day, I am talking especially to the young women, those who tomorrow will have to illuminate the life of a new home with their presence. You should know that the heart of a wife and mother are the lamps that illuminate the sanctuary, just as the spirit illuminates your inner temple. Prepare yourselves now, so that your new life does not surprise you. From this moment, go forth preparing the path to be traveled by your children, those spirits who await the hour to approach your womb and take human life and form to fulfill their missions on earth. Be my collaborators in my plans for restoration and in my work of regeneration and justice. Distance yourselves from the many temptations that beset your path in this era. Pray for the sinful cities where so many women are lost, where so many sanctuaries are profaned, and so many lamps extinguished. Extend by your example the seed of life, truth, and light that counteract the lack of spirituality in humanity. Pure young women of this people, awaken and prepare yourselves for the battle. Do not be blinded by the passions of the heart, nor dazzled by what is not real. Develop your gifts of intuition and inspiration, as well as your tenderness and sensitivity. Strengthen yourselves in the truth, and you will have prepared your best weapons for facing the struggle this life presents. So that you may transmit the love in your blood, so that you may sustain your children with the love of which I speak to you so much, you must first live it, saturate yourselves in it, and feel it deeply. That is what my teaching comes to do in your heart. Marriage and family. The law of matrimony descended like a light, which spoke through the conscience of the first beings, so that they would recognize that the union of one with the other signified a pact with the Creator. The fruit of that union was the child in whom the blood of the parents was blended, as proof that what you bind before God cannot be unbound on earth. That joy which the father and the mother feel when they give birth to a child is similar to that which the Creator experienced when he became a father, giving life to his much-beloved children. If later I delivered laws to you through Moses, so that you would know how to select a partner and would not covet the wife of your neighbor, it was because humanity, by virtue of its free will, had become lost in the ways of adultery and passions. Time passed, I came to the world in Christ, and with my gentle teaching, which is always the law of love, I elevated matrimony, and with it, human virtue. I spoke in parables in order to make my word unforgettable, and I made a sacred institution of matrimony. Now that I am among you again, I ask you, men and women, what have you done to marriage? How few there are who can answer satisfactorily. My sacred institution has been profaned, and from that fountain of life springs pain and death. Upon the purity of that law are the tracks and stains of men and women. The fruit that should have been sweet is bitter, and the cup from which men drink is of gall. You deviate from my laws, and when you stumble, you ask in anguish, why is there such pain? it is because the instincts of the flesh have never listened to the voice of the conscience. Now I ask you, why do you not have peace when I have given you all that is necessary for happiness? I have placed a blue mantle in the sky, so that beneath it you may build your nest of love, separating yourselves from the temptations and complications of the world, living in simplicity as do the birds. For in simplicity and in pure prayer, one can feel the peace of my kingdom and receive the revelations of many mysteries. Everyone who is united in matrimony before my divinity, even when their union is not sanctioned by any minister, makes a pact with me, a pact which remains recorded in the Book of God, where all destinies are written. Who can erase from that book the names of those two who have been united? Who in the world can unbind that which has been united in my law? If I were to disunite you, I would be destroying my own work. When you have asked me to be united on earth, I have granted it to you. Why do you then break your promises and deny your vows? Is it not that you are ridiculing my law and my name? I have spoken to the heart of the woman, wife, and mother who has not known how to maintain the cleanliness of her heart, nor to give to her companion and their children the warmth of tenderness and understanding. How can men and women elevate their spiritual lives if they have not yet corrected the great errors that exist in their human lives? My work requires that its disciples know how to give testimony with the cleanliness and truth of the acts of their lives. To one and all I ask, do you have children? Then have charity for them. If you could, for one moment, see those spirits, who would feel unworthy to call yourselves their parents, do not give them bad examples. Take care not to raise a scandal in the presence of your children. I know that in these times, more than ever, there are problems in the bosom of marriages that find only a single solution: distancing, separation. If this humanity had the necessary notion of spiritual knowledge, it would not fall into such grave error, for it would find the inspiration to resolve the most difficult periods and overcome the most difficult trials in prayer and spirituality. My light comes to all hearts, to the sad and the beaten, to encourage them. In the second era, I entered the homes of many marriages joined by the law of Moses. And do you know how I found many of them? Fighting and destroying the seed of peace, love, and trust, I saw war and discord in their hearts, at their tables, and in the marriage bed. I entered too in the homes of many, who without having marriages sanctioned by law, loved one another and lived like lovebirds in their nest, caressing and protecting the loved one. How many there are who, living under the same roof, do not love each other, and on not loving each other are not united, but distant spiritually. Yet they do not make their separation public, for fear of divine punishment, or of human law, or of the judgment of society. That is not marriage. In those beings, there is no union nor truth. Nonetheless, they present their false union, visit homes and temples, go out upon the roads, and the world does not judge them, because they hide their lack of love. In contrast, how many who love each other must hide, concealing their real union, while suffering from misunderstandings and injustices. Humanity has not risen to understand and judge the lives of their neighbors. Those men who hold in their hands the human and spiritual laws do not use true justice in sanctioning those cases. Nonetheless, those times of comprehension and prudence that I announce to you, in which humanity will perfect itself, shall come. Then again you shall see, as in the patriarchal times before Moses, when the union of beings was performed as I have done on this day with my children, spiritually, and as you shall do in times to come, in the presence of the parents of those to be joined, of friends and relatives, and amid the greatest spirituality, fraternity, and rejoicing.